It's estimated that between 50 to 70 million Americans suffer from problems ranging from insufficient sleep to actual sleep disorders. But the most common reason people undergo a sleep study is to diagnose a breathing problem called sleep apnea.
In the general population, it's thought that between 14 and 18 million people have sleep apnea to the degree that it disrupts their daily life.
Most have what's called obstructive sleep apnea. Its hallmark feature is snoring that sounds like snorting. This video of a patient demonstrates a severe case. The snort follows an episode of apnea where he literally stops breathing for 25 seconds. Here's how it happens. The muscles at the back of the tongue and throat relax and drop down during sleep, blocking the airway. Sensing something is wrong, the body's reflex system reacts, causing a brief arousal accompanied by a snort as airflow is restored.
So what you have is you have these intermittent falls in oxygen, you have these arousals from sleep, and you do it night after night after night.
People with severe apnea can have up to 30 episodes in an hour and not even know it. During the arousals, they don't fully wake up, but their sleep is still disrupted, causing them to be tired during the day, have trouble concentrating, be less alert, and more prone to accidents. Over time, sleep apnea can also lead to high blood pressure, increasing the risk for heart attack and stroke. Obese people face an increased risk for apnea, and new research suggests the relationship is double-pronged. Sleep apnea may cause heavier people to get even heavier.
One of the ideas is that obstructive sleep apnea changes your metabolic profile to where you're like a pre-diabetic individual. And by doing so, your insulin levels are higher, your fat deposition may be different, your tendency to gain weight may increase, so that mild sleep apnea may progress to moderate or severe because of weight gain produced by your disrupted sleep, your short sleep, and the idea of these metabolic adaptations.
Bob Lynch knows all about sleep apnea and the problems it causes. As an editorial cartoonist for the Chronicle-Telegram newspaper in Elyria, Lynch relies on creativity and alertness to draw everything from raindrops to LeBron jokes. 5 years ago, Lynch began to notice he was excessively tired during the day.
I had trouble breathing at night, and my wife noticed it at first, and I was tossing and turning all night.
Relief for Lynch comes through this mask, a treatment known as CPAP that holds open the airway during sleep with a continuous flow of blowing air, which looks really strange.
How can you possibly sleep in that?
It's actually easy. Within 30 seconds, you don't even know it's there. So I have no problem with it whatsoever.
Bob Lynch may be considered a poster child for CPAP, currently the gold standard of treatment. But many folks don't take well to sleeping in a mask. Some have nasal congestion or are claustrophobic, while others just can't deal with the look. Before trying a mask, doctors always suggest lifestyle changes, especially losing weight. Surgery to remove or remodel tissue in the back of the throat is another treatment option, but it doesn't work for all patients. Now the push is on to develop new ways to treat sleep apnea.
I'm going to listen to your heart.
61-year-old Bob Armstrong is the first person in Ohio to participate in a research study to test a new type of therapy. Think of it as tongue zapping.
Okay, Mr. Armstrong, I want to look at this scar here.
Beneath Armstrong's skin sits a stimulator surgically implanted in his chest like a pacemaker for the heart. The stimulator is connected to a sensor program to the patient's breathing patterns. When it's time to breathe, an electrical impulse is sent to a nerve in the neck, causing the tongue to stick out and preventing the airway from collapsing.
As you're breathing in, a current will go into the nerve and will stiffen or even push the tongue out just enough so that it permits airflow through the upper airway.
Armstrong says at first, the system was programmed a little too strong.
Like a lizard. My wife said I look like a lizard at night, but go like this. But now it goes about like this. Don't even see it. It just barely pushes out my tongue, so.
Armstrong uses an external device to turn on the system at bedtime. During our interview, he turned it on and we saw it work.
What is it? It's zapping it?
You're zapping it out. You see it?
Doesn't hurt?
No, it didn't hurt. But you can see it just a little bit. And I had my clear speech.
All right, Janie, let me have you bite down.
61-year-old Janie Carter has had luck with a far less invasive treatment that stems from the connection between dentistry and sleep apnea. Carter is using an oral appliance that holds her jaw forward while sleeping.
All the dental devices do essentially the same thing. If you would think about when you jut your jaw out, it brings your tongue with it, it brings all that soft tissue away from the back of your throat, and it opens up the airway.
I can sleep at night. I don't wake up. I sleep through the night. I don't feel as tired during the day.
Carter's wake-up call to apnea came when she fell asleep at the wheel.
I had to pull to the side of the road and sleep for whatever long until I woke up again.
How scary was that?
Very scary.
All right, and bring your chin down just a tiny bit. Great.
Researchers at Case Western Reserve University's School of Dentistry were among the first in the nation to use dental x-rays to measure people's risk for sleep apnea based on the location of a bone in the throat. Doctors previously considered sleep apnea as a problem affecting mainly white, overweight males with big necks. Now they know sleep apnea is an equal opportunity disorder affecting a wide range of adults and even children. Now we rejoin John Shellhouse at his appointment to learn more about his breathing during sleep.
I'm really curious to know if I stop breathing or if I need a mask or what the doctor's gonna have to tell me today.